Hi folks, hope you're okay today. It's good to be with you. My name is Jason and I'm just going to share with you a sermon. So if you'd like to turn to Romans chapter 12. We read, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. So let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day, and I pray that this message will be a blessing to people in the name of Jesus and for your glory, Lord. Amen. Amen. My title of the sermon today is Only the Best Will Do. Only the best will do. Imagine you've got a car from the 1950s in your shed. You pull the car out, it's full of cobwebs and it's manky and it's not looking good. So you get it painted, you shine and polish it, you get it fixed, and now it's nice and bright and shiny and it's brand new as if it was the car when it first rolled off the manufacturing process in the 1950s. God wants to do the same with us today. He wants to shine us up. Some of us have got cobwebs on our spiritual life and rust, and we need to get it off and we need to get back to what we should be. God wants us to move on, not to sit still in our life with God. And if we turn to Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 to 2, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that you walk worthy of the vocation wherein you are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. In other words, Paul is saying, come on now, move forward, go forward, and he wants you to go forward in your walk with the Lord. Turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 1, wherefore, lay aside all malice, all guile, and hypocrisies, all envies, all evil speaking, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the word, that you may grow thereby, if you have been tasted that the Lord is gracious. And read 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 1 to 12, in your own quiet time in the morning. But there, Peter is saying, come on, walk worthy of your calling. And my message to you today is that God says this, only the best will do. Only the best will do. It's no good living a life where we live in sin and we do sinful things and we say, oh God, it's okay. You're a God of grace and it's all right. God is saying to us tonight or today, no, it's not all right. Only the best will do. Matthew Henry says, nothing can make a man truly great but being truly good and partaking of God's holiness. Only the best will do. Number one, only the best will do as the leak needs fixing. You know, in this kitchen there was a hole once and it was leaking and it made a mess of the kitchen. And a plumber had to come in and had to fix it. If he didn't fix it, then the leak would have messed the kitchen up even worse. The leak had to be fixed. And there's a leak in your life. Something is leaking spiritually in your life and it needs to be fixed. It's no good saying, oh, it doesn't matter. It's no good just sitting there and saying, oh, God's a God of grace and it'll be all right. It's no good sitting and just thinking that it's not good, needed to be sorted out. No, you've got a leak in your life and it needs to be fixed. Romans chapter 12 verse 1, I beseech you therefore, brethren, I beseech you. When Paul says, I beseech you, he's saying, I urge you, I plead with you. This is really important, you need to deal with this. If you read 1 Corinthians chapter 1 verse 10, Paul says, I beseech you, and it's in the context of division, there's division, and he says, I beseech you. So the fact that he's saying, I beseech you, he's saying, look, this issue of disunity is important. Deal with it. Romans chapter 15:30. He says, I beseech you. And he's on about prayer. I beseech you that you pray. He's saying, this is important. Pray for me that I can preach the gospel. So when Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. Paul is saying, look, this is really important. You've got to fix the leak. It's no good ignoring the problem. It's no good year after year going on with the problem. It's no good because it's marring your ministry. It's marring your life. It's marring your relationship with God, because God says to you, only the best will do, and this leak is not acceptable to me. It has to be fixed. Andrew Murray says, Do not strive in your own strength. Cast yourself at the feet of the Lord Jesus and wait upon him, and ensure confidence that he is with you and works in you. Strive in prayer. Let faith fill your heart. So will you be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Andrew Murray. You can get the victory. There are things in your life that you're not getting victory on, but you can get the victory. The leak has been there a long time. You've been playing with the leak. You've been messing with the leak. You've not been sorting the leak out because you feel that the leak cannot be sorted, but the leak can be sorted. You can be set free. Rosaria Butterfield was a lesbian. She says, I came to Christ in 1999. I broke up with my lesbian partner because I was convicted of my sin. And she came to know the Lord, and she changed. It wasn't easy. It was not straight away, but gradually God changed her and made her into a woman where she's now married with a man. But she was set free from her issues. She was set free from her problem. You can be set free. Don't settle for second best. Don't settle for the leak. The leak is not a place to be settled in. Imagine if you've got a leak in your front room and there's water pouring in your front room and you just sat there week after week, year after year, and the water's flooding the front room, and now your feet are full of a puddle of water is in the front room and all the electrics are going down, and you just sat there in the front room week after week, year after year. You cannot settle for the leak anymore. It has to be tidied up. It has to be sorted. It has to be dealt with. You can get victory in your life. Number two, only the best will do because of the mercies of God. Only the best will do because of the mercies of God. There was a story that I was told of this mum and this daughter who was 15, and she wanted to go out and get drunk and sleep with guys and all the rest of it, as teenagers want to do. And she wouldn't let her go out. She locked the door of her room, and the daughter's banging, saying, let me out, let me out. And she wouldn't let her out. And the daughter said, my mum doesn't like me. My mum doesn't care about me. But when the daughter was 18 years of age, she realised, my mum did love me. She wanted the best for me. And now when her mum says, be careful when you go out driving, dear, don't go too fast, she listens to her mum because she knows her mum loves her. And it's hard to change if we think God is a God who's an ogre. But when we realise that God loves us, then we can change. And that's what Paul is focusing on. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by what? The mercies of God. Plural. What are the mercies of God? The mercies of God are all the doctrines and teachings that Paul has been said in Romans chapter 1, 2 and 3, we're justified by faith. In Romans chapter 5, we are in the presence of God. We are saved. In Romans chapter 6, 7, we're sanctified. In chapter 8, we are glorified. All these blessings in Christ. And chapter 9, 10 and 11 is about the election of God. We have all these blessings. Matthew Henry says, this is a powerful appeal we receive from God, the future of his mercies, the fruit of his mercies. And if we're going to change, If we're going to move forward, if we're going to have a way forward where we prepare the leak in our lives, then let us think about the mercies of God. That will help us, my friend. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4 and 5. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherein he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, and quickened us together with Christ, by grace you are saved. And Paul wants us to see that Christ died for us and gave his life. And if we only saw that and understand what Christ did for us, then this will motivate us. As we see the love of God in our life, it will motivate us to do good. 1 John chapter 1 verse 9. 1 John chapter 1 verse 9. 1 John chapter 1 verse 9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. God is a God of forgiveness. Psalm 86 verse 5. Come on now, get your Bible out. Psalm 86 verse 5. Don't sit there like a drugged up chicken now. Get your Bible out and check whether what I say is true or not. Psalm 86 verse 5. Psalm 86, verse 5. For thou, Lord, art good and ready to forgive and plenteous in mercy unto all them that call upon me. He is merciful. He is a merciful God. And he wants you to meditate on his mercy. And if you meditate on his mercy, you will start to do good in your life. In the film Les Miserables, the guy thief stole candlesticks from the bishop. He got caught and the police brought him back to the bishop, and then the bishop handed the candlesticks back to the thief and gave it to the thief, and the thief was so touched by the love of the bishop that he never went thieving again, but he became a good man. And that's what we need to do. We need to realize that Christ loved us and died for us on that cross and shed his blood for us. And if we only but understood that love, it would motivate us to be obedient in our lives. We wouldn't let the leak in our lives flow. We would block that leak and say, no, only the best will do for my Lord because he loved me and died for me. Lamentations chapter 3 verse 22. Lamentations Lamentations chapter 3 Lamentations Sorry about this when you want the book. Lamentations chapter 3 verse 22 says, it is the Lord's mercy that we are not consumed because his compassion fails not. Think about the compassion of the Lord in your life. When you're sinning and you're doing things that are not right, and you know you shouldn't be doing them, and then you keep doing it, and you keep doing it, week after week, year after year, and you love the Lord, but you keep sinning, and you know you shouldn't be doing it, and you're leaking, and the leak needs to be sorted. You need to realize the mercies of God in your life. What has he done for you? He saved you. And because he saved you, he wants the best for you. So live the best for him. Mary McShane shared, it is not great talents God blesses so much as great likeness to Jesus. Only the best will do. We've looked at only the best will do because the leak needs fixing. Only the best will do because of the mercies of God. And then thirdly, only the best will do because second best is unacceptable. Only the best will do, as second best is unacceptable. Imagine you've got somebody who is in your family, they're ill, and really serious ill, and there are two hospitals, one nearby that's falling apart, the doctors and nurses are very good, bad. Or a hospital a bit far away, but it's a good hospital, excellent staff, excellent facilities, but you have to pay a few pounds to send your loved one there. What would you do? You'd send them to the hospital that was excellent and that you only had to pay a few pounds. Why? Because only the best will do for your loved one. Well, that's what we should be with God. Only the best will do for Him. But in our own lives, we only give Him second best. But God says that's not good enough. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, here it is, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. That you present, the Greek word present there, has the Old Testament idea of when they presented sacrifices. So the idea is implicit in bringing a sacrifice in the word present. And the Lord wants you to present your life in a way that is honoring to Him. A German schoolmaster said, I go with you three times a day to eat. You must come three times a day to pray. In other words, God has given you everything. Well, why don't you give God everything back? God has sent His Son to die for you. Why don't you give your life for Him? Let us turn to the Word of God. Deuteronomy 15. If you could get your Bible, Deuteronomy 15. Deuteronomy 15:21. Deuteronomy 15:21. This sermon was preached at my local fellowship. Deuteronomy 15:21. So this is a sermon that I preached today to people. So Deuteronomy 15:21 says, "And if there be any blemish therein, as if it is to be lame, or blind, or of any ill blemish, thou shalt not sacrifice it unto the Lord thy God." If a sacrifice had a blemish, if an animal had an imperfection, you must not offer it to the Lord. In other words, the Lord is teaching you the best is only the best for the Lord. The best will only do. Deuteronomy 17:1. Thou shalt not sacrifice unto the Lord thy God only bullock or sheep therein is blemish or any evil favoredness. For that is an abomination unto the Lord thy God. And you could read Leviticus 1:3, Leviticus 1:10, Leviticus 22:20, and they all teach that a sacrifice must come without a blemish. In other words, it must come the very best for the Lord. Very often we give the Lord second best when we fall into a pattern of sin, when we continue into a pattern of sin, we are giving God second best. What we're saying is, Lord, you don't deserve the best. You're not somebody I love, really, because if I really loved you, I'd want to give you the best, but I don't really love you because I'm giving you the second best. I'm sinning. And I'm enjoying my sin, and I'm living in my sin, and I'm doing my sin, and I really, really don't give you the best. So really, Lord, I don't really love you, because only the best will do for you, and I'm not giving you the best, I'm giving you the second best. And God says to you right now, it's not acceptable. You might say, well, God's a God of grace, He forgives me, and He's a... Well, you've been saying that a long, long time, and a long, long time you've been sinning in that particular area, and God is telling you, it's not acceptable. I only have the best, says the Lord, and you're not giving me your best. 1 Peter chapter 1, 13. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13 says, "Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and hope to the end of the grace that is in it, that is brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ." Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind and be sober. What Peter's saying there is, look, be serious-minded. This is serious stuff. You know, the Bible talks about rejoice in the Lord. We're to be rejoiceful. We're to be happy in the Lord. But we're also to be serious. This idea that we can be happy, go lucky with sin. That we can just sin here and sin there and just be free about sinning and chill out. I'm a sinner. I'm going to sin. I'm going to do sin. It's no big deal. Happy clappy. I'm just going to sin here. I'm going to sin there and it's okay. I'm saved by grace. No, he says, be sober. Take this seriously. Watch your life. You can be happy and joyful, but still be serious. Still watch your life. Turn to Psalm 147, verse 11. You've got a Bible, please get this. Psalm 147, verse 11. Psalm 147, verse 11. The Lord taketh pleasure in them that, what? Fear him, in those that hope in his mercy. Psalm 33, verse 18. Psalm 33, verse 18. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that, what? Fear him, upon them that hope in his mercy. You see, they understand the mercy of God, which is the love of God, the grace of God, all the grace and the blessings of God. There is now no condemnation to them that are in Christ, but they understand the fear of God. And God is saying to you today, you don't fear me. Because you don't love me. You don't love me because you don't fear me. You've been walking in sin. You keep doing sin. And you're saying, oh, I'm saved by grace and God loves me and it's all okay. But you grieve my heart, says God to you. You're grieving my heart because deep down you don't really love me. Because if you love me, you give me the best. And you're not giving me your best. You are giving me blemished sacrifices. You are giving me sacrifices that are soiled with dirt and are dirty. And I don't want that because I deserve the best. I give you the best. I lay down my life for you. And I want you to give me your best. And only the best will do for me. For I am the God of the Most High. I am the Most High God. And you're not treating me as your God. You're not fearing me. You're not respecting me. You're trampling on my goodness. You're trampling on my greatness. You're trampling on my holiness. You're trampling on me. And you're kidding yourself when you say, I'm a God of grace. Yes, I am a God of grace, but I am a great and awesome God. And I am to be worshipped and loved and adored. For I died on that cross for you. And I gave my life for you. And I demand that you praise me. I deserve that you praise me. For I am your God who rescued you from the pit. I am the God who set my love upon you. I am the God who drew you with the cords of love. I am your God. And you grieve me when you do not give me your best. Will you not give me your best? And will you not give it me out of love? Out of a love that I loved you, that I laid down my life for you. Only the best will do for me. And you're not offering the best for me. You're offering me blemished, dirty sacrifice. It's second best and it's not acceptable to me. In fact, it stinks. It stinks because it's way below that I expect of you as my child. I provide all the resources for you. I have provided the Holy Spirit. I have provided your redemption. I have provided the Word of God. I have provided fellowship. I have provided your practical needs. And you might find that it's tough, and you might find that you're leaking in a certain area, but that is no excuse to give me the second best. I demand and deserve only the best. So sort the leak out and move forward. And give your best. And if you really love God, you will fear Him. If you really love God, you will fear Him. None of this hap, clappy, slap. There's nothing wrong in being happy clappy, but when I mean happy clappy, I mean happy clappy in terms of sin. Where you just sin and it's no big deal. There's nothing wrong in dancing, singing, praising God. Amen to that. I'm on about when you're just blasé, happy clappy with sin. It's no big deal. I can sin here, I can sin there, and God is going to cover me with His grace. No. It's not acceptable. It's not acceptable. God says, I only the best will do for me. Do you fear Him? Do you fear God? Not a fear where you've got a dog and an owner who's nasty, and the nasty owner wants to kick the dog, and the dog is cowering and fearful of the owner. When it says fear God, it's not that kind of fear. It's more like a fear where you go to the doctor, and the doctor tells you you've got cancer, and you have got cancer. And because you respect the doctor, you obey what the doctor wants you to do. You respect the doctor because the doctor knows what he's doing. It's that same fear and reverence and respect with God, that you reverence Him, that you respect Him, that you believe that He knows what He's doing. He is the God who is to be worshipped and praised, and I respect Him and I honour Him. And I'm going to watch my life. I'm going to make sure that my life doesn't go down areas that dishonors my Lord. That's the kind of respect that God wants you to have for Him. That's when you really begin to show that you love Him. Read 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 16 to 20 is about sexual sin. Read Romans 6, 16, 18 talks about we can be delivered from sin. Read James chapter 3 verse 6 to 18 talks about the tongue and not allowing our tongue to help us to fall into sin. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God. Major Thomas says, the moment you come to realize that only God can make a man holy, you are left with no option but to find God, to know God, and to let God be God in your life. Puritan writer William Gurnall says, So final conclusion. Well, only the best will do as the leak needs fixing. Only the best will do because God is a God of mercies. Only the best will do because God, because as second best, is unacceptable. God has not called us to religion, He's called us to a personal relationship with Him. And it says there, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is what? Your reasonable service. The Greek idea there, reasonable service, means when it says reasonable service, it's saying that your mind is focused on God. That's why it's reasonable. As opposed to outward observance. The Jews were masters at the outward observance. They were masters of outward show. But Paul is saying it's your reasonable service, i.e. your mind is worshipful. Your mind is captured by the truth of the Word of God. Your mind is captured by obedience to God. That is your reasonable service. The reason is focusing on God, not outward show. That is what he means by reasonable service. We need to focus on the truths of God's word in Romans 5 verse 8. But God commendeth his love to us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. We need to focus on that. Focus on the love of God in our lives. You can read Romans 5:20-21. By the wages of sin is death, by the gift of God is eternal life. All the blessings that are in God, let us focus on the mercies and goodness of God, and it will inspire us to deal with our sin issues in our life. Secondly, Psalm 147:11, about the fear of God. That God loves it when we fear Him. We need to fear and respect God and reverence Him. J.C. Ryle says, I cannot see how any man deserves to be called holy who willfully allows himself in sins and is not humbled and ashamed because of them. J.C. Ryle. He says, I cannot see how any man deserves to be called holy who willfully allows himself in sins and is not humbled and ashamed because of them. We have lost the ability to be ashamed. We have lost the ability to be humbled by our sin. William Tiptoft said, O Lord, keep our hearts, keep our eyes, keep our feet, keep our tongues. William Gurnall says, blind zeal is soon put to shameful retreat, while holy resolution built on principles lifts up its head like a lock in the midst of the waves. In other words, if we have firm principles of holiness through the Word of God and obedience to Him, and we lift the principles of the Word of God, then we'll be strong in the storm. But if we live a life of zeal, but is mixed with sin and mixed with things that are not right, and not based on biblical principles, not based on obedience to the Word, then we will be put to shame. Only the best will do. Nothing else is acceptable to God. Will you give Him your best? We've all failed, we all make mistakes. But it's time to go up that little notch higher than you've ever done in your Christian walk, to begin to move in the higher realm of the spiritual life, in going for all that God has given you, all that God wants for you, and being obedient to Him. That leak is going to get sorted out, and you're going to move forward in a way that you've never moved forward before, and it's going to be wonderful. So some of you are going to be upset, some of you are going to be crying, some of you are going to be humbled by this message, some of you are going to be sad, some of you are going to be challenged, some of you are going to be encouraged. But whatever this message has done, it's because of the Holy Spirit working in you, and God is only doing it because He loves you and He wants the best for you. Let's pray. Father God, we thank You for Your love, we thank You for Your grace. We thank You for Your mercies, we thank You for Your joy. And Father God, I just thank You for Your goodness today. And I pray, Father God, that You bless this message to people's hearts. May it be a blessing, Lord. May it be an encouragement. May it be a challenge. And may it lead us all to live a holy life and bring glory to Your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you for listening, and God bless you. And have a lovely day. God bless you.